When I was at the Esri user conference a few weeks ago, I met someone who had gone on a whale watching tour, and they had actually seen, honest to goodness, blue whales. Blue whales? You can see blue whales in San Diego? Turns out you can. I checked out the data on Movebank, and it's pretty awesome. I'm gonna show you how to make this animation of seasonal blue whale migrations in ArcGIS Pro. Let's dive in. This is movebank.org, an amazing collection of animal migration data. I'm going to search for blue whales, and I'll choose this study, which tracks tagged whales from 1993 to 2008. What a time! I'll take a look at the download info, and good news, it's Creative Commons by, which means I just have to cite it, which is totally cool, and I'll download it as an Esri shapefile. Boop! Dun, 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 dun. And here it is. And I'll just unzip it to my project folder. I don't need the lines, I'm not going to use them, but it doesn't hurt to have them. I might want them later. And now, my friends, let the mapping begin. Here we are in ArcGIS Pro. I'll open up the catalog pane and look at my default geodatabase for this project. And you know what? Let me just see if this will work. Drag it into new. Worth a shot. It didn't work. Worth a shot. Okay. So I'm just going to right click this and choose import. And I'll go about it the geoprocessing way. I'll navigate to my file folder and I'll add them to this geodatabase. And I have to hit refresh so I actually see them in the database. And then I can just drag in my whale sighting points. Now I'll add a little bit of context. I'm gonna give this background an imagery base map. And now I have a sense of where these whales are actually swimming around. Let's give this map a much, much more interesting coordinate system. I'm going to choose the world from space. It's like an orthographic perspective of Earth floating in space. It looks 3D, but it's 2D. So when I pan it, it just moves the map instead of spinning it. It's 2D. And notice how when I move my mouse around, these little coordinates at the bottom update. I can use those to update my projection to better fit the extent of my data. So I'll open up my map properties, and I'll right-click my current selection and choose copy and modify. That opens up the properties, and I'm going to change this to negative 121 and a latitude of 35. And I'll save this, and this just creates an updated version of this projection with customized coordinates, and it's a much better fit for my data. Now we can play with our base map just a little bit, and I want to punch up the water. I want to make it a little bit more vibrant, so I'm going to go to Living Atlas, and I'll search for a layer called Bathymetry Light. And then to visually blend this into the imagery base map, I'll do a layer blend of overlay, making the oceans more lively. Next, we'll symbolize the point features for these whale sightings. In the symbology panel, I'll give the fill a gradient, and I'll give it a light blue to a sort of cyan, kind of cool aquatic looking thing. And then I'll give this an outline width of 0.7 and make it white. But because there's so much overlap with these points, I'm gonna fake a drop shadow. So I'll go into the structure and I'll duplicate this symbol layer, and I'm gonna reformat this to look shadowy. I'll turn off the top one for now so I can see what I'm doing, and I'll choose format polygon symbol, and instead of a linear gradient, I'm going to choose a circular gradient, and I'm going to make it go from fully opaque black to fully transparent black, as I am wont to do. And I have to just tweak this size so that it ends at fully transparent, and we have something that looks kind of shady. So now I'll hit the back button in my symbology panel, and I'll turn back on that topmost layer, but now my shadow is covered up. So I'll make it a little bit bigger, and I'll use the offset distance to just nudge it over down and to the right. Little shadow. Now let's take a look at what attributes we have in this layer. So I'll open the attribute table, and we have a timestamp. That's great. If I scroll all the way to the end, I see there's another thing called date, which is actually today. It's the day I downloaded this. Very scary. So I'm just going to delete that garbage. And there's one called time, which is empty. I'll delete this too for housekeeping. And then I'm going to add a field called month, because I want to isolate just the month from that timestamp. And then there's a little bit of tradecraft involved here. You have to go up to the field and hit save at the very top in the ribbon. And here it is, my new month attribute. Now I'm gonna use a sweet, sweet arcade function to isolate the month from that timestamp. And if I look at this reference, which I found online, there's an option called ISO month, and that'll give me a value from 1 to 12, where 1 is January and 12 is December. Perfect. I'll fire up the trusty old field calculator, and here I'll change my expression type to arcade, and I'll just type in ISO month, and then in parentheses, I'll add my timestamp. I'll check that it's cool. It is. I never know. And let's see what we get. Numbers 8, 9, 10. Let's check that against our timestamp. Months of 8, 9, and 10. We're good. And now I'm going to make 12 separate copies of this points layer by holding the Control key and dragging them. It's a quick way of duplicating layers. And then I'll just name these layers 1 through 12 so I can keep them straight. And then I'm going to filter each one so that it only corresponds to that month. I'll open the layer properties, go to the definition query, and choose month equals, and then the number. And I'm going to switch it over to SQL and then copy this so I can paste it quickly and edit it in the rest of these layers. Month equals 1, month equals 2, month equals 3, etc. So my result is 12 individual layers, each layer corresponding to a month of the year. Not only is the blue whale the largest creature on Earth, it's the largest creature ever on Earth. Maybe. And now it's time for a layout. I'm going to insert a new layout and I'll choose custom page size. And there is no pixel option. So I'm going to approximate the dimensions that I want in inches. So 10.8 inches wide by 19.2 inches tall. That's the same thing as the Instagram dimensions, as long as we keep the proportions the same. And I'm going to snap in my map. And one of the things I love about layouts is that I can snap to the edges. It makes it so convenient. So if you don't have snapping turned on, definitely turn that on. And then just some housekeeping. I'm going to get rid of the default black outline around this map frame by giving it a line thickness of 0. Next, I would like to arrange my map better within this layout. So I'm going to activate the map frame by right-clicking it, and then I'll zoom in, but by golly, it just doesn't fit. My data is too horizontal and my layout is so vertical. So I'm going to open the properties of this map frame and go to this second tab here, and I'm going to give it a rotation of negative 60 degrees. We'll see if this, yes. Now our composition aligns well within our layout. And I'll just turn off the rulers now because I don't really want them right now. And I'll fine tune the position of my map now that I've rotated it. So I'll reactivate the map and just zoom it, pan it till it fits perfectly. When I was a kid, one of my favorite cartoons had a character who wore a swim ring around his waist. The character's face was mirrored perfectly in a miniature version on this swim ring. I thought that was fascinating. I'd like to do something similar for an overview map, a mini-me version of the main map. So I'm going to copy this map frame and just paste it again in the layout, and I'll resize it way down to an overview size. And then I'll just activate this overview map frame and zoom out so that you can see the whole world. And then I'll exit that activated navigation mode, and I'll rename this to overview. And I think I'd like to unrotate this map in the overview map frame. Now, if you look closely, you can see some text on my main map and my overview map. Let's take a closer look. These are service layer credits. This is citation information for the base map and for the vector bathymetry overlay. Now, by default, you can't move them or change how they appear. But if you go into the Insert tab, there's an option to insert service credits. And then I can just position it anywhere on the map, and it gets rid of that problem of redundancy, and I can style it. We'll add additional citations here later on for the whale data. Now, of course, we want our map to look cool. And the easiest way to make any map look cool is to give it a coordinate grid. So with my main map selected, I'm going to insert a grid, and I'll just choose this first option here. And we've cast this cool looking grid over our map. See what I mean? I want to change how it looks. So I'm going to open its properties and go into this second tab here and just delete everything except for grid lines. Labels, ticks, they've got to go. Just give me the grid lines. And I want to change how they look because I want to make them semi-transparent white. Why? Because I think that looks cool. Classy. An adult blue whale is the same size as 2,670 average-sized men who have been squeezed into a whale-shaped mold. Let's take a look at this overview globe. I want to give it a sense of mass. I want to enthingify it. And I'll do that in a really hacky way using a bunch of graphics. So I'm going to insert a circle and make it about the same size as this Earth. And then I'll open its properties and choose the symbol tab so I can change how it looks. And I'm gonna make this line a gradient stroke. And this gradient stroke is gonna end up looking kind of like a little atmosphere. So I'll make it thick, like 10 points, and I'll give it an offset of half of its thickness so it only renders on the outside of the line. And I'm gonna give it a gradient of blue to transparent blue. And I'd like to soften this gradient a little bit and make it less linear. So I'm going to add a couple stops and then nudge them closer to the right. So it's more abrupt right at the edge of the Earth and then tapers off slowly. And next, I'll duplicate this outer gradient and flip it so it renders inside the globe. I'll make it a little bit skinnier and I'll make its offset negative so it renders inside the globe. And then I'm going to mirror its gradient direction so it looks like it's kind of hugging inward instead of growing outward. And the result is a nice little hazy atmosphere. Now for the fill, I want to give this globe a spherical sense of depth. So I'm going to give it a gradient fill, and it'll go from a darker semi-transparent blue into a fully transparent version of that blue. And then I'll just play with this gradient, pushing a lot more transparency into the center of the globe and making the outer edge of the globe more opaque. This just gives our globe more of a realistic, rounded appearance. It's the little things. And since round, realistic things cast shadows, let's add a fake shadow. I'm going to insert another circle. This time I'm going to draw it over to the right and below the globe. And I'm going to drag this layer beneath my overview map so it renders under the overview and on top of the main map, if that makes any sense. And then I'm just going to style this so it's a circular smooth gradient with a black center and a fully transparent black outline. And the result is just a nice little shadow. And while we're playing around with these silly little tricks, let's get extra silly and put in a reflective shiny top to this globe. I'm going to grab an ellipse and I'm going to insert it on the top of the globe, and I'll rotate this. And I'm going to give it a gradient of semi-transparent white to fully transparent white. And for some reason, it just works. And the result turns something that's kind of flat and sterile into something that looks alive or real or touchable, has some physics to it, I don't know. Now you may have noticed this void at the North Pole, and it's there because the imagery and bathymetry don't extend all the way to 90 degrees. I could have put a patch behind it, but we lucked out because the background is pretty much the same color, and at the scale we need, it's good enough. A blue whale is equivalent in weight to 642 school buses, each filled completely with seawater. When creating a layout, you're always trying to balance your composition. And right now, our map is awfully bottom heavy. So I'm gonna add a rectangle to this layout. And then on this, I'm going to add the title. And I'll put it at the top so it can lend visual balance to this layout. I'll open this element's properties so I can style it. And I'm gonna give it a gradient that looks kind of glassy. So it'll fade off at the edges and be semi-transparent white in the middle. And I do this by giving the fill a linear gradient, and then I tweak the color stops in the color scheme editor. And I'll change the angle to 0 degrees so that the gradient is horizontal. And now I'm gonna hack in a fake shadow. So I'll make a copy of this rectangle and paste it just below the first rectangle and make it a little bit shorter. Now I want this shadow to be vertical, so I'll change its angle to 90 degrees and I'll give it a gradient of deep dark sea blue to a fully transparent version of that blue. And the result is a subtle, or maybe tacky, depending on your opinion, drop shadow. And then I'll add the title itself. I'll insert text and name it Blue Whale Migration. And I'll give it a font of trusty old century Gothic. I'll give it a nice big readable font size. And I'll also go into the letter spacing and get crazy. The larger the letter spacing, the better it looks. And I'd like to give this title a glassy light look to match its background plate. So I'm going to format this polygon symbol and give it a linear gradient, vertically oriented from white to semi-transparent white. Below the title, I'm going to add a reference for the month of the year that we'll use in the animation later. So I'll duplicate the title text and then just rename it J for January. And I'm going to make it a little smaller, but bolder. And then I'll change the color grading a little bit to make it even dimmer because I want these month letters to be a vague reference that will sit behind the currently selected month. And then I'll just duplicate this letter so I have 12 instances of it, one for each month. And then in the text tab, I'll distribute these horizontally across my layout. And I'll align them so they're aligned. And then rename the letters to correspond with their month. And I'll definitely rename them in the table of contents so I can keep them straight. Never, I mean, always label your layers. And then I'll group all of these month text layers and name it month's background. And next I need to make a version of these month labels for when they are selected. So I'll duplicate this group and name it month selected. And later in my animation, each one of these label layers will be used in each frame of the animation. And I'll just quickly change the style for each of these labels to be fully white at the top of the gradient so that they're brighter. Because this is an animal migration map, I think we need some sort of pictorial representation of a blue whale here. So here you are in Wikimedia Commons, and there's not a whole lot here, except this is kind of interesting. It's not even a real photo of a blue whale. It's better. Good news, it's CC 2.0. I can use it. And then I freed it from its background in some random image editing application. And then I asked myself, what would Wanmei Liang do? Maybe nestle this blue whale right into the title banner. So that is what I'll do. And to help sell the illusion that this blue whale is diving over our title banner, I'm going to insert a rectangle and just cover up this little bottom bit of its tail with a semi-transparent version of that background color, which I can sample with the eyedropper tool. And because that was an effective bit of tomfoolery, I'm going to crank this up to 11 and draw a polygon behind the whale in front of the banner and give it a semi-transparent gradient to look like it's casting a little shadow over this title for some reason. And now that I have all the things that require citations in place, I can update this citation to include data credits, image credits for that cute blue whale, and my name. Because like my mom said, always sign your work. And then I'll show only the January label and only the month of January's data. And I'll export that as an image. And then I just do that 11 more times, one for each month of the year. So here's that month of January's blue whale locations in the 1080 by 1920 aspect ratio of Instagram videos. And here are all the other months, which we can arrange in time and just play through like an animation. You can use the Instagram app itself to make your animation, or you can make your animation elsewhere and then just like have it, man. I like a website called EZ-Gif.com. You can upload your images, set the frame rate, choose to fade between frames if you want, and it makes you an animated GIF. And you can actually use the same site to convert that GIF into an MP4 file size, which is way more efficient and friendlier with social media sharing. And that is how you take beautiful animal migration data, create a layout in ArcGIS Pro, and then stitch it into an animation ready for social media.